Welcome to the first hearing of our session this morning on the criminal justice and race in the United States of America. A special welcome to the United States, the state of the United States, who requested this hearing, and we are very encouraged by that. We also have joining with us three representatives from civil society: the American Civil Liberties Union, Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law, and the Center for Constitutional Rights. The timing will be a little different in this hearing, given that it is the state that requested it. They will have 25 minutes to make their presentation, which is a bit longer than normal, and then we will give the petitioners 15 minutes for their presentation collectively, that is. So we will be already 6 minutes late, so we will proceed. Thank you. And before I proceed, let me introduce, as I said, it's the first day of the first hearing, so I'm a little rusty, introduce you to my panel. On my right, I have former president of the commission, Commissioner Tracy Robinson. On my left, I have another former president, Commissioner Felipe Gonzalez. We also have with us Commissioner Rosa Ortiz, who is the Rapporteur for the Rights of the Child. And we have with us not commissioner, but secretary of the executive secretary of the commission, and I am Rosemary Antoine, the current president of the commission. We may proceed. Thank you.
Thank you, distinguished commissioners, distinguished members of the commission, and representatives of the ACLU, the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under the Law, the Center for Constitutional Rights. My name is Anthony Pahagian, and I'm the alternate representative at the United States Mission to the Organization of American States at the Department of State. It is an honor to be a part of the U.S. delegation and share some of the highlights of the United States' effort to eliminate racial discrimination and uphold our human rights obligations and commitments. We thank the Commission for convening this very important thematic hearing today. We are also delighted that Commissioner Rose Marie Bellantoine, the Rapporteur on the Rights of Afro-Descendants and Against Racial Discrimination, is present today. We would take this opportunity to thank you for your work addressing these issues during your tenure with the Commission. I can state without hesitation that the United States strongly supports the work of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights and its work to protect and promote human rights in the hemisphere. We acknowledge the positive impact the Commission has had on the laws and practices in many countries and the lives of innumerable individuals. We have pulled together a distinguished group of U.S. officials to address the Commission today. First, we have Zakiya Carr Johnson, Director of the Race, Ethnicity, and Social Inclusion Unit at the State Department. And this is in order of presentation. We also have from the Department of Justice, Deborah L. Spence, Research and Development Division, Office of Community-Oriented Policing Service. From the Department of Labor, Christopher Seeley, Chief of the Regulations Branch, Policy Division, Office of Federal Contract Compliance Programs. And finally, although she hasn't quite arrived yet, from the U.S. Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, Carol Miaskoff, Acting Associate Legal Counsel, Office of the Legal Counsel. I'll now turn the floor over to my colleagues. Zakiya.
Good morning. This year marks the 50th anniversary of the Selma to Montgomery marches. Because of campaigns like this, a Voting Rights Act in the United States was passed. Political and economic and social barriers began to come down. Earlier this month, President Obama, community leaders, activists, and thousands of other marchers gathered in Selma to commemorate the 50th anniversary of Bloody Sunday. President Obama acknowledged that while great progress has been made, the march is not yet over, and that it is a mistake to suggest that racism in the United States has been eliminated. The United States is a constant work in progress. The United States also recognizes that combating racism and discrimination is not just a domestic issue. It is a challenge faced by every nation, and particularly in this region, a challenge that we can all work together to overcome. In 2013, 2013. The United States joined consensus on the UN General Assembly Resolution 68-237 to create the International Decade for People of African Descent, observed from 2015 to 2024. The International Decade is an opportunity for a positive discourse on U.S. civil rights, highlighting the 50th anniversary of the U.S. Civil Rights Act and a narrative of common challenges following the tragic incidents in Ferguson and New York. Our efforts also build on the U.S. on our U.S. government engagement during the International Year for People of African Descent in 2011. Through action plans, and my unit works diligently in the Bureau of Western Hemisphere Affairs on action plans on racial and ethnic equality signed with Brazil and Colombia, the Department of State supports cooperation and dialogue between our governments, civil society, and private sector on equal access to education, access to justice, economic opportunity, and entrepreneurship, access to environmental justice, cultural preservation, and racial equity in health. We're applying what we've learned from these action plans to facilitate exchanges and share good practices in diversity, social inclusion, and racial equality throughout the Western Hemisphere. In May 2014, the U.S. government signed an MOU on racial and ethnic equality and social inclusion with Uruguay. We agreed to cooperate and exchange information in areas such as increased access to education at all levels, equal protection under the law and access to the legal system, improved enforcement of domestic and anti-discrimination laws and policy, and increased access to health care, credit, and job training. And at the Organization of American States, we've provided input for an exchange of best practices for the Permanent Council's Committee on Juridical and Political Affairs, special session on the International Decade for People of African Descent, as a follow-up to a resolution on the decade passed at the General Assembly in Paraguay in June of 2014. It is our plan to do more to make the decade meaningful in this region. We have the pleasure of coordinating regularly with our interagency colleagues that work tirelessly to address discrimination on the domestic front and in international programs. We're also pleased to engage with civil society because they keep us accountable. They enhance our understanding and offer solutions to challenges that remain. One important lesson Selma teaches us is that justice and equal opportunity require sustained action and effort. That is why the U.S. government remains deeply committed to fighting racism and racial discrimination at home and abroad. Thank you very much.
Good morning. My name is Deborah Spence, and I currently serve in the Department of Justice Office of Community-Oriented Policing Services, which is more commonly known as the COPS Office. But today I'm here in my capacity as the project manager of a very special initiative that the department recently hosted, the President's Task Force on 21st Century Policing. In a democratic society, trust between law enforcement agencies and the people they protect and serve is essential to the stability of communities and the integrity of our criminal justice system. The fear of oppression and discriminatory law enforcement can be as debilitating to a community as the fear of crime. This has become abundantly clear in observing the public demonstrations that have been taken up across the country in the aftermath of the deaths of Michael Brown, Eric Garner, and others. Police use of force may be the immediate cause for gathering, but the protests are clearly about historically strained relationships devoid of trust and respect. Established by an executive order on December 18, 2014, the Task Force on 21st Century Policing faced an ambitious goal and an equally ambitious timeline. It needed to examine a broad range of issues facing contemporary policing and identify the best practices and otherwise make recommendations to the President on how to promote effective crime reduction while building public trust. And it needed to present an interim report on these recommendations to President Obama by March 2nd of this year. Under the leadership of co-chairs Charles Ramsey, the commissioner of the Philadelphia Police Department, and Lori Robinson, professor at George Mason University, six pillar areas were identified to guide the task force in its work. These were building trust and legitimacy, policy and oversight, technology and social media, community policing and crime reduction, training and education, and officer wellness and safety. In January and February of this year, the task force hosted seven public listening sessions, six subcommittee meetings, and four deliberation sessions on each of these pillars. Through these sessions, which were held in D.C., Cincinnati, and Phoenix, as well as through stakeholder meetings, written testimony, emails, and even Twitter, the task force engaged federal, state, local, and tribal officials, representatives of non-governmental organizations, academic and technical experts, young leaders, and the general public. Nearly 150 people contributed oral testimony at the listening sessions, and they were all consistent in their thoughtfulness and passion for helping to improve the practice of policing in this country and to develop stronger relationships between police and communities. All of these contributions led to a report with nearly 60 recommendations and hundreds of action steps. They are all concrete principles and strategies that the task force confidently believes can bring about long-term improvements to the ways in which law enforcement agencies interact with and bring positive change to their communities. Although I'm a fast talker, I can't share all 60 recommendations with you in my allotted time this morning, but I can highlight a few I think are of particular interest. First is that the task force calls upon law enforcement agencies to acknowledge the role of policing in past and present injustice and discrimination, and how it is a hurdle to the promotion of community trust. This theme emerged in the first listening session in DC, where Jennifer Eberhardt of Stanford University told the task force, "Bias is not limited to so-called bad people, and it certainly is not limited to police officers. The problem is a widespread one that arises from history, from culture, and from racial inequalities that still pervade our society and are especially salient in the context of criminal justice." And it continued through every other session, notably in Phoenix, where a panel of police chiefs described what they were doing in recent years to recognize and own that history and to change the culture within both their police forces and their communities. Another common theme that ran through many of the hearings and more than one recommendation is the need for greater diversity in the recruitment, hiring, and promotion of police officers. Many witnesses spoke to the complicated issues of diversity and recruiting, including Sherilyn Eiffel of the NAACP Legal Defense and Education Fund, who said of youth in poor communities, "By the time you are 17, you have been stopped and frisked a dozen times. That does not make that 17-year-old want to become a police officer." Ultimately, law enforcement agencies should strive to create a workforce that contains a broad range of diversity, including by race, gender, language, life experience, and cultural background to improve understanding and effectiveness in dealing with all communities. What also carried through so many of the recommendations is that community policing emphasizes working with neighborhood residents to co-produce public safety. As Dolores Jones Brown of the John Jay College of Criminal Justice testified, neighborhood policing provides an opportunity for police departments to do things with residents rather than doing things to or for them. Public safety is the responsibility of all, and the effective management of it requires collaboration across agencies, sectors, and communities. A compelling example of this was presented by Chief Charlie Beck of Los Angeles when he spoke in Cincinnati. For the LAPD's Community Safety Partnership Program, the department assigned 45 police officers to serve for 5 years at three housing projects in a community called Watts. The officers went into these housing developments with the intent not to make arrests, but to create relationships, hear the community, and see what they need, and then work together with the housing authority and the residents themselves to make those things happen. What I see as the most striking finding of the interim report, though, is not the profoundness of any given recommendation, but the fact that they are the consensus opinion of what was a very diverse task force. Whatever their backgrounds and experience, they agreed that these are the steps to move the profession of law enforcement and our communities forward. While every task force member and witness brought their own perspective, they could all agree that individuals are more likely to obey the law when they trust that those who enforce it will treat them with dignity and respect, regardless of what they look like, where they live, or whom they love. Working with this task force was an incredible honor for my colleagues and me, and I share the opinion recently expressed by our director, Ronald Davis, of profound optimism about the progress we are poised to make in ensuring that our communities are safer places for everyone, where a culture of trust between police and communities they are sworn to serve only grows over time. Thank you for the opportunity to share this optimism with all of you.
Good morning. My name is Christopher Seeley, and I am the Branch Chief of Regulatory, Legislative, and Policy Development at the U.S. Department of Labor's Office of Federal Contract Compliance Programs, or in short, OFCCP. I'm honored to appear today before the Inter-American Commission of Human Rights to discuss the Department of Labor's role in protecting American workers from workplace discrimination. In the few minutes I have, I will broadly describe the work of OFCCP, as well as various priorities and initiatives of the Labor Department. Like the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, OFCCP investigates individual and systemic discrimination complaints. However, OFCCP primarily focuses on conducting compliance evaluations of companies that do business with the federal government to deter and remedy workplace discrimination. Through the federal contracting and procurement process, OFCCP enforces laws and regulations that protect workers from discrimination based on race, color, religion, sex, national origin, disability, status as a protected veteran, and beginning on April the 8th, 2015, OFCCP will enforce Executive Order 11246 as amended to protect workers from discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity. To enforce these laws, OFCCP examines federal contractors' affirmative action programs and analyzes their personnel activity data, which includes compensation information and records related to hiring, promotion, and termination decisions. Through both qualitative and statistical data analysis, as well as on-site reviews and interviews, OFCCP investigates whether a company is discriminating and determines whether to move forward with requiring remedies. Where discrimination is found, OFCCP seeks make-whole remedies in a number of ways, such as settlements that may require back pay with interest, job offers or reinstatement to members of the protected class, or front pay. As part of a settlement, OFCCP may also require that the company to engage in personnel reforms or take other actions such as personnel policy changes, training, or improved monitoring of selection or compensation decisions. If settlement efforts are unsuccessful, the Solicitor of Labor may institute legal enforcement proceedings seeking remedial and/or corrective actions to cure the violation or violations, and the solicitor will seek the authority to debar a company from receiving future federal contracts or modifications or extensions of existing contracts if the company does not timely comply with a remedial order to correct the violation. I will also highlight that OFCCP has followed the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission's lead in investigating potential systemic discrimination when companies choose to rely on job applicants' criminal history records for purposes of employment decisions. In 2013, OFCCP issued a policy directive citing studies that show stark racial and ethnic disparities in incarceration rates. The OFCCP directive made clear that policies excluding people from employment based on the mere existence of a criminal history record, without taking into account factors such as the age and nature of an offense and the nature of the job, that those policies are likely to unjustifiably restrict the employment opportunities of individuals with conviction histories. In addition to the important work of OFCCP, other agencies at the U.S. Department of Labor, including our Bureau of International Labor Affairs, or ILAB, have programs and initiatives that may be of interest. For example, ILAB has funded projects in Brazil, Colombia, Ecuador, and Panama to reduce child and forced labor, particularly addressing systemic issues of discrimination among historically marginalized communities, such as those of African descent. The United States, under State Department leadership, also has action plans to eliminate racial and ethnic discrimination and promote equality with Brazil, Colombia, and now Uruguay. These action plans include labor and employment as one of the priority areas of focus. Officials from the Department of Labor, Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, and other agencies from across the U.S. government have participated in these regional racial equality meetings with our counterparts from the region, civil society, labor, and others involved over the years. Also, I'd like to highlight that Department of Labor's Employment and Training Administration houses the Reintegration of Ex-Offenders program, which consists of a portfolio of grant projects providing pre- and post-release services to both eligible youth and adult offender populations. An important goal of the program is to develop strategies and partnerships at the state and local levels that will reduce recidivism and improve the workforce outcomes for ex-offenders. As these efforts demonstrate, the Department of Labor is strongly committed to protecting workers from discrimination at home and around the world. We look forward to the ongoing conversation with our colleagues across the U.S. government about the work they are doing to combat discrimination, and look forward to continuing to work with our international partners on this important issue.
Good morning. My name is Carol Miaskoff, and I'm the Acting Associate Legal Counsel at the U.S. Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. The EEOC was created in 1964. We opened our doors on July 1st, 1965. We were created by the Civil Rights Act of 1964. And from the first day, our mission has been to combat discrimination in employment under Title VII of the Civil Rights Act, which includes race, color, national origin, religion, and sex, as well as subsequent non-discrimination in employment laws that the federal government enforces. What's significant, I think, in terms of how we relate to the Department of Labor and the OFCCP is that we cover all employers who engage in commerce in this country, regardless of whether they have a federal contract or not, if they have 15 or more employees. So that is in the private sector. We also cover state and local government employers, which include public safety agencies, police, fire in local communities, though we do not litigate against these entities. The Department of Justice does the litigation, so we split with them in that regard. Finally, we also enforce these laws with respect to the federal government as an employer. So we hold ourselves to the same standard that we hold others to. The EEOC receives, we function by receiving what we call charges or complaints of discrimination from individual workers who have experienced discrimination in the workplace. We investigate these, and if we think there is cause to find that discrimination occurred, we will meet with the employee and the employer and try to work it out, basically. If it cannot be worked out, we sometimes, in very frankly rare instances, will bring suit ourselves. We select the cases that we litigate in terms of their priority subject matter, the number of people who are impacted. And one area in which we are litigating now does involve exclusion of people with criminal records from the workplace. Overall, to give you a feel for the numbers involved, we received 88,778 charges of discrimination in our fiscal year 2014. Of those, 31,000 were race discrimination. For many years in our history, race discrimination was the largest number of charges until only a few years ago, and now they have been overtaken by charges alleging retaliation, which is an interesting point. Retaliation not being a personal quality, but rather an employer's action against someone who exercises their rights under the Civil Rights Act. In fiscal year 2014, we brought 133 lawsuits. Those lawsuits, again, were on priority issues, or they were systemic and involved a lot of people. finally, we do enforcement by outreach and education. And in fiscal year 2014, we actually reached more than 236,000 people in our outreach events, and we offered 3,500 no-cost educational events, often to employers, also to employees on both sides of the aisle, so to speak. As examples of our activities, in 2012, the Commission issued a guidance on the use of criminal records in excluding people from employment. This guidance was an update, actually, of existing guidance that had been in place since the 1990s. And it's interesting to say that historically, we started receiving complaints of discrimination involving sweeping exclusions of people with criminal records basically as soon as we opened our doors in the 1960s. So there is a long history of complaints in this regard. The commission has investigated this for many years, has issued decisions on this, and then recently updated our policy guidance on this, in large part because it is such an important issue in society now. And we felt that the guidance that we had in place could be bolstered by all of the statistics that are now available that really show that without a doubt, policing disparately impacts minority communities. So we issued that guidance in 2012, and we coupled that guidance with litigation efforts. We now have two ongoing cases involving exclusion of people with criminal records. One involves the Dollar General retail store, and the other involves the BMW auto plant in South Carolina and a contractor of those. And in both of these cases, we have good documentation of the racial disparate impact, as well as the qualifications to work of the people who were excluded. In terms of one other litigation that we've brought that I think is relevant to race discrimination, I'd like to highlight our case against DART Energy, EEOC versus DART Energy. DART Energy is an energy company in the state of Wyoming. The work is dangerous, and people need to look out for each other. We filed suit on behalf of 17 claimants alleging race and national origin discrimination. These men worked on oil rigs and they worked as truck drivers. The claimants were subjected to racially and ethnically demeaning and disparaging comments on a regular basis. In the words of one of the claimants, they felt that their lives were in the hands of people who judged them by the color of their skin. Another claimant said that working there was one of the worst times in my life. When they complained to their managers, the managers took no action. When the complainants eventually filed charges of discrimination with the EEOC, many of them were subjected to discipline, up to and including termination. And that's retaliation, which I said is now actually surpassed race. We eventually settled this lawsuit for $1.2 million and a 3-year consent decree that changed practices at the employer and ordered other equitable non-monetary relief. As these examples illustrate, EEOC's mandate is to stop and remedy unlawful employment discrimination. It remains relevant today as when it did when the agency first opened our doors 50 years ago. As the demographic makeup of the United States continues to change in the 21st century, the EEOC is prepared to address the challenges resulting from our increasingly diverse multicultural workforce. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll now ask the petitioners to address us, and welcome again.
Good morning. My name is Jessalyn McCurdy. I'm a senior legislative counsel at the American Civil Liberties Union, and I appreciate the opportunity to testify at today's commission hearing on race in the criminal justice system in the United States. The U.S. criminal justice system disproportionately impacts African Americans and Latinos, perpetuating a harmful legacy of racism that stretches back to our nation's founding. A compelling example of how this country continues to struggle with race in the criminal justice system was documented by the U.S. Department of Justice's recent investigation of the Ferguson, Missouri Police Department. The national spotlight turned to the suburb of St. Louis last summer after Officer Darren Wilson of the Ferguson Police Department killed an 18-year-old African-American man named Michael Brown. The fatal shooting sparked protests across the country. as Ferguson police and officers from surrounding jurisdictions responded to the protests, the citizens of Ferguson were met with military-style equipment, such as armored vehicles, shotguns, M4 rifles, like those used by forces in Iraq and Afghanistan. This response only served to escalate the rising racial tensions in this small community. In an effort to calm the increasingly dangerous and chaotic situation in Ferguson, the Department of Justice agreed to conduct an investigation into the police department, as well as determine whether federal criminal civil rights charges could be brought against Officer Wilson. The department's report on the Ferguson Police Department confirmed many of the ACLU's suspicions about the unlawful and unconstitutional police practices in that city. After a six-month investigation, the department found a pattern or practice of police misconduct in Ferguson that violates the First, 14th, and Fourth Amendments of the Constitution and federal law. The report concluded that Ferguson police engage in racially biased policing, regularly targeting and harassing African Americans. Furthermore, Ferguson police regularly stop people without reasonable suspicion, arrest them without probable cause, and use unreasonable force. The police often make enforcement decisions based on individual speech that they disagree with. The report found that the city of Ferguson prioritizes city revenue over public safety, and African American residents are paying the price literally and figuratively in a debtor's prison culture. Too often, citations for minor traffic offenses in Ferguson snowball into jail time, and if there are missed court dates and unpaid fines, for one African American resident, a $151 parking ticket turned into 6 days in jail and over $1,000 in fines. In 2013, over 9,000 arrest warrants were issued in Ferguson, a community of 21,000 people, for parking infractions, traffic tickets, or housing code violations. In the city's effort to collect the $2.4 million it ultimately generated that year in revenue from fines and fees. Although only making up 67% of the population, African Americans in Ferguson make up 92% of the cases in which arrest warrants were issued, and 96% of those arrested for municipal offenses. The Ferguson police regularly carries out racially biased policing with excessive force, the report found. The report also found that from 2012 to 2014, African Americans made up 85% of the vehicle stops, 90% of the citations, 93% of the arrests, and nearly 90% of the documented incidents of use of force. The report also indicated that police dogs were used exclusively against African Americans. DOJ's report paints a disturbing picture of the situation in Ferguson, but also stresses it's not an isolated situation. The investigation and report must serve as a model for police departments around the country to address strained police and community relations. Also, we cannot be desensitized to the fatal shootings, police shootings of unarmed black men and women, such as Michael Brown, nor can we ignore and not condemn the shootings of police officers, such as those who were shot a few days ago after the police chief in Ferguson resigned. The recommendations of DOJ's report can be used by police departments and communities across the nation to begin to heal the wounds that have resulted from poor relations between law enforcement and the communities they serve. If the culture of policing changes, not just in Ferguson, but in police departments across the country, to better reflect community policing and to restore trust, it will go a long way to heal the wounds of the past. Thank you very much.
My name is Nahal Zamani, and I'm with the Advocacy Program Manager with the Center for Constitutional Rights, or CCR. We are a legal and educational organization working on a number of issues. First and foremost, we want to thank the Commission for holding this important and, we believe, very timely hearing. We have a larger written submission that we've touched on many aspects of the criminal justice system. However, today we're going to be focusing on discriminatory policing practices as well as police violence. We'll also be focusing on the New York City Police Department, or the NYPD, which is the largest and arguably most influential police department in the United States. As the commission may already be well aware, the NYPD's practice of stop and frisk targeted racial minorities and used race as a proxy for crime. Between January 2004 and June 2012, the NYPD conducted 4.4 million forcible pedestrian stops of New Yorkers, 85% of whom were Black or Latino, even though they only represented 52% of the population in New York City. Not only was the program racially discriminatory, it was also inefficient. Only approximately 10% of stops led to any further law enforcement action. Weapons were only recovered in a very minute fraction of all stops. Evidence in our class action lawsuit challenging the NYPD's stop and frisk program proved and revealed that the NYPD explicitly used a profile, male, Black, 14 to 21, to target minority youth in the city. The trial proved that racial discrimination and not criminal suspicion was behind NYPD street encounters. In August 2013, a federal court ruled in our case finding the NYPD liable for widespread practice of unconstitutional and racially discriminatory stops and frisks. They ordered the appointment of an independent monitor that would oversee a series of reforms to the stop and frisk practices and bring the NYPD into compliance with the Constitution. And here, what we think is very significant, they ordered a collaborative reform process that would begin together the stakeholders that were most affected by these policing practices to name the specific and develop the specific reforms to the stop and frisk program. Now, we believe that these collaborative reform practices should become the model for what we do and how we engage in meaningful, lasting, and credible reforms to municipal police departments across the country. Already in the DOJ's recent report on the Ferguson Police Department, they observed the need for civilian input into all aspects of policing. Another reason why this collaborative process is so essential is that diverse hiring or training, those are not going to fix everything. We need the police department's willingness and volition to engage in wholesale cultural change. Without it, systemic violations of people's lives and rights will continue. I want to touch on three more themes. One, broken window style policing. Two, police violence. And three, racial and religious profiling. Now, I talked about stop and frisk. That's just the tip of the iceberg. The NYPD, like many other police departments, does engage in overly aggressive and discriminatory enforcement of minor and low-level offenses with a disproportionate impact on communities of color. And this is not just a minor inconvenience. This can be a very fatal one, as was illustrated in the murder and killing of Eric Garner in New York. Furthermore, there is a culture of impunity for police violence, which runs rampant among too many police departments across the U.S. Officers who engage in misconduct and brutality are rarely held accountable or adequately punished. Add to that, repeat failures by the judicial system to hold these officers accountable for illegal conduct ensures that this impunity continues. The NYPD did also engage in widespread surveillance and profiling of Muslim communities without any suspicion of wrongdoing, and use religion as a proxy for crime. Now, we have a number of recommendations that we'll urge the commission's and the US government's attention to in our written submission. We do just want to thank the commission for this important hearing and reiterate the importance of all levels of government, both municipal, federal, and state, to uphold the US human rights obligations. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Barbara Arnwine, and I am the president and executive director of the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law, a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization established over 50 years ago at the behest of President John F. Kennedy. I would like to commend the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights for holding this hearing and undertaking to examine these critical and pressing issues related to race and the criminal justice system in the United States. As the Commission is aware, recent killings of unarmed African Americans by law enforcement have cast a spotlight on America's criminal justice system. Nationwide protests and demands for reform continue today. Efforts to respond by the U.S. government include the Presidential Task Force on 21st Century Policing, a Department of Justice investigation of the Ferguson, Missouri Police Department and Municipal Court System, both of which have released reports in the last 2 weeks. And we also recognize the new DOJ guidance on racial profiling, even though we think there are significant problems with it. We commend the U.S. government on taking these initial steps and believe the content of each report are steps in the right direction. However, to read the Ferguson report as being only about Ferguson, Missouri, or the task force's interim report as a panacea for reforming the criminal justice system overwhelming effect on communities of color would be a mistake. The Ferguson report's finding of racialized policing and abusive municipal court practices are emblematic of towns and cities across the United States. These policing and court practices mutually reinforce systemic discrimination that needs to be addressed on a larger scale. Similarly, the Ferguson report and interim policing report address only the tip of the iceberg of the crisis of mass incarceration. While the importance of law enforcement as the gateway and public face of the criminal justice system cannot be overstated, these reports do nothing to address racial disparities that grow from other stages, such as the broken windows policy, pretrial detention, bail determinations, prosecutorial charging decisions, or harsh sentencing regimens. These reports reveal just how far America has to go to comply with the international civil and human rights obligations for a fair, just, and equal criminal justice system. For instance, NIDA report connected its findings or recommendations to the fact that over 2.3 people sit right now behind bars in the United States, making our country the world's number one incarcerated. The rate at which the U.S. imprisons our own is about 7 times higher than the Western European democracies. The reports do not mention that every person arrested by the Ferguson Police Department now have a criminal record, joining the ranks of the over 65 million Americans with a criminal record, the existence of which affects their ongoing ability to get a job, provide for their family, contribute to society, receive public assistance or public housing, no matter how severe their need, or obtain educational loans and occupational licenses. The Ferguson investigation and interim report of the policing task force do not contemplate the second-class citizenship, which results when a criminal justice system targets poor and minority communities across an entire nation. From the first police stop through criminal charge, trial, sentencing, prison, and after release, individuals of color are treated differently and far worse than their white counterparts. Statistics consistently show that African Americans and Hispanics are imprisoned at a higher rate than whites in the federal and state systems in all age groups. Additionally, the U.S. has international human rights obligations to address these disparities in our criminal justice system. While we applaud the steps that the U.S. government has taken to document and address some of these disparities, including the recent release of the guidance, more needs to be done. The Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination has recommended that all states create a national plan of action to implement the treaty, as well as a central agency or commission to educate the public and monitor treaty compliance, and we urge the U.S. to adopt such a national plan of action. This plan would be a living document that aids in the planning, implementing, and monitoring of governmental efforts to address racial discrimination. In conclusion, there is no way to describe the United States criminal justice system except as one of mass incarceration, a historically and globally unprecedented phenomena. The most distinguishing characteristic of this system is that it has been disproportionately inflicted against people and communities of color with severe consequences. It is the hope of the Lawyers Committee that these reports signal a beginning of the work to be done by the U.S. government to restore equality, fairness, and justice to our nation's criminal justice system. International civil and human rights obligations demand it and provide a sound basis for the dramatic reform that is so direly needed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the perfect timekeeping as well. I'm now going to ask my colleagues to make a few observations, ask a few questions in particular. I will start with the country rapporteur for United States, Commissioner Felipe Gonzalez.
Thank you, Madam President. Good morning to both delegations. First of all, as a country reporter for the United States, I would like to express my appreciation for the fact that the U.S. government requested this hearing. This kind of hearing requested by a government is an opportunity to enhance and further discussion and analysis about an issue that has been calling the attention of the Commission for quite a long time, and gives also the opportunity to exchange opinions with the civil society. And in, as a general point, the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights values when a state requests a thematic hearing, given the showing its willingness to have an open analysis of the issues at stake. I think both the presentations were very interesting, and I would like to ask both delegations about the ways the civil society participate in these issues. To what extent the civil society has the opportunity to become involved in the kind of programs that were described here, and to what extent the civil society has also the opportunity and to exercise its rights to monitor the situation on these issues. Are there obstacles to this participation and this monitoring? And if so, what can be done to enhance that participation and monitoring? And also, as a general point, I think there is an issue underlying all this discussion, which is to what extent the actions and policies on the part of the government are reactive ones, or are really part of a policy of prevention. I would like both parties to elaborate on this as well, to what extent the actions being taken by the government, both at the federal and local level, can be seen as a whole approach to prevent the repetition of these issues, or are mostly reactive? Thank you.
Commissioner Robinson.
Thank you very much, President. I first wanted to also thank the state for requesting the hearing, and also for its acknowledgement that activists and human rights defenders have been instrumental in helping the state to make the advances that it has so far, and its recognition that we have some way to go. One of the questions I had was for counsel for the Equal Opportunities Commission, and to hear whether there are statistics which would help us to understand the percentage of claims in favor of applicants in relation to race discrimination and the change over time. In other words, can you determine whether there's progress in addressing these issues from the statistics which you have available? The second was, I think the request from the state for this hearing is an acknowledgement that international human rights norms and the international human rights obligations of the state matter. And I'm interested to hear, and I think this question was raised by the participants to the hearing on this side, how do the obligations under CERD, under the ICCPR, impact the day-to-day policies of the federal government or state authorities as well? And then my third question is to strongly encourage the state in hearings like this to include the participation of states. Having heard significantly from others about the DOJ study on Ferguson, it's very, very clear that states and municipal authorities are integral to this change. And the Commission would welcome the opportunity to hear, to have your delegations include state authorities that can tell us the progress which is being made at the state level and municipal level in relation to these issues, and particularly in relation to issues beyond policing, including the issues of prosecution, adjudication, access to counsel, a range of other issues which are implicated by race and the criminal justice system.
Gracias, Presidenta. Muchas gracias. a los representantes del Estado y de la sociedad civil. Gracias por permitir a la Comisión Interamericana hacer parte de esta, de este debate que nos interesa sobremanera. Felicitar al Estado por la las iniciativas que nos presentaron, sobre todo la de Policía Siglo XXI y los planes de acción que mencionaron. También por el interés en tratar este tema como un desafío en el cambio cultural. Y el cambio cultural hacia una cultura de derechos humanos es la más favorable para esta situación. En diversos países de la región hemos acompañado este mismo proceso y ese cambio de cultura hacia una cultura de derechos humanos comienza sobre todo con el tratamiento de los derechos humanos de los propios policías. Es decir, que ellos puedan comprender los derechos humanos de las otras personas debe iniciar por comprender sus propios derechos humanos. Y ese es el proceso que a lo largo de la región se está trabajando. Ahora, escuché también con mucha atención sobre el interés de trabajar la discriminación no solo en Estados Unidos, sino también en otros países. Y me consta la cooperación de Estados Unidos a través de USAID en el cambio legislativo del sistema penal en muchos países de la región. Pero quisiera traer a colación una aparente contradicción. Es que como los demás países han ratificado ciertos tratados de derechos humanos que Estados Unidos no ratificó, esos cambios son diferentes. Es decir, los cambios penales en los demás países no son a lo que ocurre en Estados Unidos, iguales a lo que ocurre en Estados Unidos. Entonces sería bueno considerar si Estados Unidos estaría en condiciones, por lo menos, de plantearse ratificar ciertos tratados pendientes. El de derechos del niño es fundamental para el número de adolescentes que en Estados Unidos son tratados como adultos. Es impresionante y es casi único. No se diría solo en la región de las Américas, sino en el mundo. Y el número de adolescentes privados de libertad no contradice justamente el enfoque de derechos que enfatiza, como bien dijo el comisionado Felipe González, enfatiza no la reacción sino la prevención y una policía comunitaria cercana a la población que hace parte de otras fuerzas como para prevenir la comisión de delitos y no solamente actuar una vez que se comete alguna infracción. Creo que con eso quisiera poner a disposición la comisión a través de sus distintas relatorías y la mía en particular de niñez y adolescentes para poder trabajar juntos estos temas. Gracias.
Thank you. As Rapporteur for the Rights of Persons of African Descent and Against Discrimination, I must acknowledge how I think the world might be ecstatic at the United States actually requesting this hearing and to see, I see this as some significant progress. I see we've had Barbara Twine, for example, before with hearings that we have been pushing this issue, my rapporteurship and my team, from actually the very beginning, and we feel that we are making some progress. One of the big issues we confronted, of course, was what we conceived of as the invisibility of the issue. It, as fate would have it, the Trayvon Martin tragedy occurred in my first couple of weeks of my tenure as rapporteur. And so from since then, we have in the rapporteurship been wanting to change the emphasis from basically Latin America, which we had done some work before, to North America, because we believe that there were still, and we still believe that there are entrenched racism issues that we needed to confront. So this is really a big step for us at the Commission and for the rapporteurship. It has not been easy. I mentioned invisibility, and that translates into lack of funding. My rapporteurship is still caught up in this issue of not having enough funding. We have said we wanted to do, and we will be doing, a report on criminal justice and race. And I think it's important to say this, and invisibility has practical consequences. But we are very encouraged at the call of this hearing and what we, the information that we heard today. But I agree, and I think we all agree, that this is just the beginning. It's just the beginning, because racism, of course, affects not just people of African descent, as far too long it has been treated in that way, but it affects the entire nation and, of course, beyond the entire rule. And like my colleague, Tracy Robinson, I am also encouraged that the state's participation is an affirmation, and also the participation of civil society, which has had not had a long history with the commission on this issue. It's an affirmation of the role of international standards and of the Inter-American Commission, a legitimate role, and we feel that we can support the state and peoples of the United States in this very important work. We are now beginning to see statistics, which we've been asking for, and thank you very much for those. We continue to harness them. I didn't hear much about it today, but it's an underlying issue and something that our report found, our 2012 report on race, which was the way in which the criminal justice system impacts on economic, social, and cultural rights. A very important issue for us, and of course it's a vicious cycle, as we know, and it links with poverty. I wanted to ask just a couple questions, which one to the Deborah Spence, in terms of your report and the very important work on the task force. Yes, how do we transmit, or is there a plan in place to transmit the lessons learned from this very important task force to the public? So getting it out there, and not just with those persons who you interviewed, and not just the public in the particular state, but to echo what the petitions were saying, this is a nationwide issue. How do we get that information out to the entire nation, given that racism is a social construct? That was one, a sort of a plan in place. Another question I had was about employment practices on the Equal Opportunities Commission, which is doing good work. But again, when we think about hiring practices which may be discriminatory, there are some persons who never get even to that stage of even applying for a job because of the entrenched racism. Is there a way that the commission, not necessarily the commission, but any bodies that are working in a sort of coherent, unified way with other social programs to recognize this and to bring persons, to have, whether it's social programs, outreach programs, training, to be able to get persons to the application process? I think that's all part of what we know to be a very sort of proactive approach, which I think some of my other colleagues were asking. But this is a very complex issue, multidimensional. We will welcome all of the written reports that I see are coming, and I want to just congratulate all of us for this important start. And now we will now have 3 minutes each to make further comments, questions, queries. We know there are lots of things we can't specifically answer. We welcome some of your answers in written form. So the state.
Thank you. I just want to say very quickly that we want to thank the commissioners and our colleagues across the table for your comments, insights, and questions. We will continue the work we have to do to live up to our own constitutional standards. I'd like to turn it over to Deborah Spence, maybe to answer at least one or two of the questions quickly.
Sure. There was an early question about the ways in which civil societies participated in our task force process. In fact, three of the task force members represented organizations known as Make the Road New York, the Advancement Project, and the Equal Justice Initiative. So the task force was very balanced between civil society organizations and law enforcement and government. We also had testimony from the Constitution Project, from the ACLU, the Anti-Defamation League, Amnesty International, the Senator for Constitutional Rights, and numerous others. And then as to your most recent question on the plan to transmit to the public. The interim report of the task force is actually available on our website, which is www.cops.usdoj.gov. We have all of the materials that the task force reviewed in the course of their work, too. So all the written testimony that was submitted by everybody to the task force is up there as well. But so the interim report is there now. We are currently working to create a final report that the president is going to ask for any day now. And there are ongoing media and promotion efforts around making sure that word of that report gets out and that anybody can get a copy.
Thank you again for the opportunity to discuss these important issues. In terms, the two questions that I have are somewhat related, or we could look at them that way. One is, can we at the EEOC assess the progress of applicants who have criminal histories in getting jobs from the statistics that we keep? And the short answer to that is we don't have specific numbers at EEOC in terms of the number of applicants who have successfully been hired despite having criminal records. I can explain more how our systems work, but we don't have that kind of data. We do, our outreach that I discussed is very significant because that has resulted in some large companies. For example, I think Costco, as well as others in the Seattle area, deciding to do away with early criminal record checks in their hiring process. So we have sort of soft information like that. But I would think that it relates to the second question, which is getting people in the door to even apply for jobs and getting over what us lawyers called a chilling effect. And I think there are a lot of social programs around the country who are working hard on this. At the federal level, there is a Federal Reentry Council that President Obama created that coordinates people from all the federal agencies. But frankly, my understanding is that these are more local programs and that they have met with significant success in preparing applicants, in working with employers, and in bridging the gap during that transition. Thank you.
Yes, please, petition.
Sorry, thank you. Just a couple things. Again, thank you for this hearing. The Civil Rights Coalition on Policing Reform, which the Lawyers Committee facilitates, is a coalition of over 27 plus, you know, major civil rights organizations throughout the country. We work with Black Lives Matters, Hands Up, Don't Shoot, Dream Defenders, and others. Our problem, as we see it, with the involvement of civil society is that it's at the discretion of the government, that it's not routinized, or you know, there's no process that's established. I mean, the task force was great, but that's a one-time event. That is the problem that we identified about there being no national action plan that would, in fact, you know, routinize, make that much more common and predictive. We also believe that one of the big problems is the difficulty of monitoring what's going on because of the lack of data, which is pointed out in the 21st Century Report, but that makes transparency very hard regarding police killings, arrest records, etc. Last two points quickly. There needs to be some serious focus on the pardons for the thousands of Ferguson victims. If we all accept that this was an illegal system that was put together by the Ferguson Police Department and Municipal Court, and that these people were being arrested illegally and racially targeted, then we know that they all now have criminal records. Those records should be expunged, they should be pardoned, they should not have to suffer the consequences of that discrimination, and there should be some consideration for damages. Lastly, the Lawyers Committee has some publications on best practices for employers and using regarding criminal records and arrest records that we would be happy to share with you.
Thank you again. I absolutely want to echo that this is a really significant moment. The U.S. Government is on the tail end of three separate treaty review processes, and just in 2 months we'll be up for the EPR review. And I think it was absolutely because of the vehement lobbying and advocacy by civil society that made and I think supported the various committees' attention and scrutiny to the issues of policing and prisons, particularly during this last year. Now we have to implement all the suggestions and address the areas of concern, and we, I believe all of us, are really eager towards rolling up our sleeves and working with various governmental entities. Briefly on preventative tactics and reactive tactics. Preventative, first, the federal government does play a role, and they can withdraw their support and end the program 1033, especially towards police departments which are known to engage in discriminatory policing. The New York City Council should pass the Right to Know Act, and all police departments should not target Muslims, Arabs, and South Asians, and they should all end this broken window style of policing. In terms of reactive, we urge the continued involvement of the DOJ, especially in their investigative powers. It's been quite necessary. We've seen very recently for municipal police departments that have typically answered to no one. And as well, we would urge the creation of a national database tracking excessive use of force and brutality and killings more widely.
I also want to thank the government for requesting this hearing. I think it's a great step forward. I want to also respond to the question of prevention versus reaction as well. I think one of the most telling things for me in the context of the Ferguson protest was when the police chief got on TV and said that their role was to protect the public safety, and that all that makes sense ultimately, but it was clear that they did not see the public as the protesters, that the public that they were protecting was different from the protesters that were asserting their First Amendment rights. And you saw that again as it looked like they were waging war against the protesters by using military style equipment to respond to the protest. And so that does tell you that it is more of a reactive environment. But one of the most, I think, important recommendations, in the very first recommendation that has to take place that came out of the report from the Department of Justice, is that police agencies and law enforcement officers have to take on a changing of their culture. And the changing of their culture is important because they have to stop looking at, for example, communities of color as communities that they're waging war against, and look at those communities as communities that they are serving and protecting, and not using those communities as cash cows in order to generate revenue.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank all of you today for coming to this extremely important hearing. Once again, the State of the United States for requesting the hearing, and the three groups of petitioners who gave us such valuable information. I would like to echo the call towards continued dialogue. The court has asked for collaborative reform. The commission is asking for collaboration, continued collaboration between petitioners and the state, yes, working proactively towards a national plan of action, which we think, and we would like to encourage you to continue working with the commission. Thank you all, and thank you for this very large audience here today, for being part of the public who needs to be changed. Thank you very much.